In this video, we'll start from scratch and you'll get a template that we're going to use throughout the video series to build up your website. But the real focus of this video is your homepage. So by the end of it, you'll have a homepage, it'll be customized to you, and we'll even have customized some parts of that appearance. So to get started, we're going to use a Quarto command to get a template. So I'm over here now in RStudio. I don't have a project open, but I'm in the terminal pane. And on the terminal pane, I'm going to use Quarto. And this function is called useTemplate. And what you give useTemplate is a GitHub repository. And this command's just going to grab the contents of that repository and bring it down to your computer. So we're going to use a template that we've prepared for this series. Never spell Emil's GitHub username right. So I'm actually going to copy and paste that in. So this is of the form sort of repo owner, Emil Hvitfeldt, and then the repo name, so website template. And I'm going to hit return, and Quarto's going to run off and get that for me. It's going to ask a few questions. So do we trust the authors? Yes. Do I want to create a subdirectory for the template? So you can see I'm currently on the desktop. I do want to put my website in its own directory. So I'm going to create a subdirectory and I'm going to call it website. I need to answer yes first. I'm going to create a subdirectory for the template and I'm going to call that directory website. So Quarto goes off and it pulls down all the files in that template and brings them down locally. And you can see I've now got this website folder sitting on my desktop. And I'm in RStudio. I'm going to actually open that as a new project. So in RStudio, I'm going to File, Open Project. And I'm finding that website folder on my desktop. And opening that up. If you're in something like VS Code or Positron, you might want to open up that workspace. So that just makes sure that when we're on the terminal, that's going to be in the right place. And you can see our file browser is also in the right place. So these are all the files that are brought down. And a lot of these files are going to be things that we're going to talk about and build on in later sessions. Today, we're really just going to focus on two files, index.qmd and _quarto.yaml. So I'm going to open up index.qmd. So like any Quarto document, this file has some components in it. And the first one being a YAML header. So we've got the three dashes indicating the start of the header. And then all the options are inside that, ending with another three dashes. Then everything else in this file is the content. And that's in Markdown, like any other Quarto file, and it could have code cells in it, just like any other Quarto file. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm actually going to preview this. So in RStudio, that's the render button. If you're in VS Code or Positron, it's called preview. Basically does the same thing. That's going to run it through Quarto and pop up a preview of this file. And because this is a website project, and we'll talk more about how Quarto knows it's a website project later, it's going to look like a website when you preview it. I've got everything zoomed in here, so we're sort of actually seeing what this would look like more on a mobile device. So sometimes you want to pop that out into something like, you know, into your web browser to see what that would look like more generally. And that's one of the really nice features of Quarto websites is that they have this property that they scale down to mobile size really nicely. This is our template website, and you can see it's built for this fictitious person called Alicia. We're going to work through the components of that index.qmd file to figure out how this all goes together and what you need to edit to make it your own. So I'm going back to RStudio. I'm now still in this index.qmd file. So the first place we'll start is in that YAML section. And you can see that some of these YAML items are translating directly into content on this page. So we've got a title that says Alicia. That's that big name. And the subtitle is sort of coming on underneath. If this was me, maybe this wouldn't be Alicia, or it would be Charlotte. Maybe I'd like my last name. Maybe I would change that I'm also an educator as well as a data scientist. Right, and if we make those changes, we save that file, we can rerun the preview. I tend to use the keyboard shortcut for that. I'll run that now. And you can see that those changes are happening right on that homepage. So some of the things here are controlled in this YAML, right? We've got the title and subtitle. You might guess that this image is controlled by that image key, and it is. But the rest of the content on this page is actually coming from the content part of our document. So the template has it set up with a couple of headings like education and experience. It's entirely up to you what you put there, right? You might have a little paragraph just describing who you are. A really sort of lazy way I like to do this is just to put in some placeholder text, knowing that I'll come back in later. Here I'm using the short code LIPSUM, and it just adds in sort of a paragraph of text. Let me show you that over in the web browser. There's a ton of text there, probably way too much. Let me dial that down to just a paragraph. So this particular page is actually a special kind of page in a Quarto website called an about page. And what an about page does is it uses a template to combine things that are defined in YAML with the content of the page. So we've got sort of these title and subtitle, that's coming from YAML, and then everything that's the content you can kind of see here. And then way down at the bottom, you'll actually see there's also a couple of links to GitHub and LinkedIn. And those again are coming from the YAML. So let me show you that. So the way you make an about page in a Quarto website is you use this about key in your YAML. And these about pages, like I said, are based on a template. The template we're using here is called Holla. There are a few of these. Let me just show you another one called Trestles, just so you can see what kind of changes those templates make. And I'll show you that in a bigger picture. Right, so the difference here is now the image is on the left along with the title and subtitle and links, and all the content is kind of on the right, with this little bar on the dividing them. So you can head to the docs. There's a link right there in the YAML to see what other kind of templates you can pick. And then those links are defined in this YAML too. So there's a link to GitHub. I might put my own GitHub in there. Maybe I don't want a LinkedIn link, so I can just delete that. And when I preview that, that sort of changes those links there. So that gets you a long way to a really custom homepage. The other thing I haven't shown you here is how to change this image. So that image you can see in the document YAML, I've got an image key and it says profile.jpg. That is coming, well, that is referring to this file sitting at the top level in that directory. So the paths you provide to image should be relative to the location of the file that they're in. Index.qmd is sitting at that top level. So when I say profile.jpg, it's just looking at the top level for that image called profile.jpg. I found an image earlier that I'm going to include here. So this is the image I found earlier. It's a nice picture of some trees. What do I do if I want to use that instead of the template one? The easiest thing is probably just to rename that. So this came from Unsplash, so thank you to Deglix Ganzorig for that image, but I'm going to just change it so it's got the same name as what the template is currently expecting, profile.jpg, and I'm just going to drag it into my website folder and say yes, I do want to replace what's there. Right, so I'm literally just replacing this image file with something different. So I'm going to preview it, and then it should pop up with that new image. And you can see there it is there. If I go back over to the Safari version, you can see there it is in the view you get on a bigger screen. I actually think now my image is taking up a bit too much room. There's this cool option in the About key that controls the image shape. So I'm going to look for image shape and I'm going to switch to round. I think that just makes it a little bit smaller. You can see on a bigger screen that just fits a little bit better. A homepage is as easy as that in Quarto. You can use this template. You can edit the YAML to change a lot of the things on the page. And then the actual sort of content becomes integrated in that about template and also shows up on the page. There are some things on this page, let me go to the Safari view, that aren't controlled in that file, right? You'll notice that there's sort of a navigation bar at top. It's got perhaps some redundant links to home and there's a search up there. And then there's a footer at the bottom of the page too. So some things in your website are controlled not in a Quarto file, but in this _quarto.yaml configuration file. So I've opened it up. And it's this file here under the project key and then type where it says website. This is how Quarto knows that this folder, this directory called website, should be treated like a website. Then there's a key called website, and this controls a lot of the parts of that website, the nav bar, the title of your website, whether social's turned on, what the footer looks like. These are the other components that you see on that page. This is where they're controlled. And then the final thing in here, under format HTML, these are the HTML document settings that are going to apply to every page in your website. So this is where you can control the appearance of those pages. And that's something that I'm going to hand you over to Emil to tell you more about.
So in this first round where we are changing the colors using the YAML file we've been using so far, there's a couple of different options we can set that changes the way the website looks. And those attributes are font color, link color, background color, and mono background color. And they're fairly self-explanatory. The font color is the color of all the text on the website. Link color is the special color of whenever you have a link going out. So if you have a link, all the, some of the buttons have to use this color as well. Background color, as we expect. And the mono background color isn't something we're using right now, but if you're using any code chunks using R, Python, or JavaScript, it will use this mono background color. So to see how we can use it, we're moving back into our website we've been using so far, and we move over to the Quarto YAML. And inside, down here in format HTML, we can go and say, start by changing the background color. So the background color, if we type slow enough, we get this autocomplete hint. So let's see if we can get a background color that's a light green happening. A nice little light green. We can make it maybe EE, FFEE. So now we have to complement the greenery in our image, we can use some greens that match. To do font color to also show, we can also pit some of these built-in color names that are accepted with CSS. So here we can use a dark green that we can see is being used here in the plain text. And lastly, we have this very neon green link color right here in the GitHub button. So let's see if we can fix that. And let's to maybe go back, see, then we made it all the way black too. So now when we hover over this button, it turns all the way black. That's the way the link works. We don't have any real links in the website right now, but that will be controlled using this link color option. We can also see that there's many different ways of selecting a color. I've showed both using these RGB hexadecimal values, which you can easily find color pitters for online or downloaded apps. There's also a long list of named colors, but there is many other ways we can select color for our website. And these are nothing special. They're all the standard CSS ways of selecting color. So knowing these is very useful as a general tool. The fonts we can select come in two different ways right now. We have the main font, and then the font is used everywhere on the website, and the mono font, which is used for code across the website, which we don't really have right now. We select these in slightly different ways. We'll explain it real fast. So it's typically called a font family. So it is a name denoting what font should be used. And you might have seen whenever a font family is selected, it has this comma separated approach. We're getting this comma separated approach because it allows for the idea of fallbacks. So if the first selected value isn't available, it will set the next one and so on and so forth. This allows for mistakes or slow internet. If it can't download the most preferred font right away, it will fall back to a font such as the sans serif, which is available on all machines. So the way we find that is we go back to our website and we say, main font. And now we need to find an option. So let's say, what happens if we just pit serif? And we see right away that the font updates. So now it uses a serif font. We can also, I want to say monospace. So selecting a monospace font isn't really the most appropriate font for like a body text, but we can see here it's being selected out and being used all across. In some of the later videos, we will show how to use any font you want. Right now, we're limited to some of these more system-level fonts. And last thing we can do is change the sizes. And the main three sizes we can kind of change right now is the max width, which is the width of the text area of the page, the font size, which is the size of the font, and the line stretch, so the distance between the lines of text on a page. All of these sizes can be specified in a million ways because it is CSS, but common sizing includes like the pixel sizing. So we can say 18 pixels high or 100 pixels wide would be too much. So we can go back in here, we can say font size. And so let's try to go all the way up to 20 pixels. And now if we pull it out here, we see that it got better. So finding the right size is, like, there's no right way and no wrong way. Of course, it needs to be not too big and not too small. Anywhere around like 15 to 20 is a reasonable default, but it will depend on the font you choose. So if you choose a different font, it might just naturally be smaller than other fonts, and you would have to adjust the font sizing accordingly. So now that we created our first slightly custom website, it would be fun to be able to show it to someone else. There's many ways of doing it, but one of the ways I really enjoy it is with this thing called Quarto publish. So it's a terminal command, and we simply type Quarto publish. That will publish it out to a number of different places, but we can specify specifically some different locations. So we can also do Netlify and other hosting sites, but we have this Quarto pub place where you can create an account and publish your Quarto stuff. So we run Quarto publish Quarto pub, say yes to my email, I give it a name, so I can call it home, that's fine. We'll wait a little bit, it will render locally the website before it pulls it up, and then it starts uploading, and we wait a second. And now we have the website we just created on this website that's now available for everybody to see. So that is a one very quick way of getting your website out into the world.